Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for our sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross.
So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say,
altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Ferguson Heights Church of Christ morning virtual worship services. I want to thank each and every one for tuning in and turning on to our virtual worship here at the Heights. I trust and pray that each and every one of you all had a great week and will have a better week ahead. Our message this morning will be brought by Brother Minister Gary Lodge, and he'll be preaching out of 2 Kings. The title to the sermon is Secrets of Tragedy. Secrets of Tragedy. It should be a good one. It's going to be a good one. Let us pray for the remainder of this service. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this another blessed day, Father, to please you and praise you with purpose and passion, Father. We thank you, Father, for allowing us to make it through another week, Father. We thank you, Father, for watching over and protecting us as we slept through the night. And Father, every morning we wake, every breath we take, every moment of every hour, we live under your power. And Father, we ask that you touch us with that same power, Father. For if you created us from nothing, you can certainly recreate us. And Father, as this world is changing around us, we ask that you not let the world change us, Father. But we ask that you do change us, Father, to be more holy and righteous and loving and kind toward one another, Father. And we thank you for that. And Father, we ask that you not let us be drawn by what is evil, Father, nor take part in wicked deeds. Father, we ask that you help us to be led by your Spirit and not be glorified by the desires of our sinful nature. And these blessings we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray, amen.
Jesus, Jesus, how I love calling your name. Jesus, Jesus, every day your name is the same.
Oh, Jesus,
Jesus,
sweet Jesus,
Jesus,
how I love
calling your name. Jesus,
every day,
your name is the same.
Trouble around me, Lord, I didn't have to despair. Cause Lord, you told me you would be right there. Seems like my problems had just begun. But I didn't have to worry no more, cause they're already won. Oh, Jesus,
Jesus,
sweet Jesus,
Jesus,
how I love
calling your name.
Oh, Jesus,
Jesus,
sweet Jesus,
Jesus,
every day
your name is the same.
Have you ever lost someone that was so close to you? Death, it hit you so hard till you didn't know what to do. You called on the Savior when tears running from your eyes, but you didn't have to worry no more, cause he was right by your side. Oh, Jesus,
Jesus,
my rose,
Jesus,
lily of the
valley, how I love calling your name.
Oh, Jesus,
Jesus,
sweet Jesus,
Jesus,
every day
your name is the same.
Oh, Jesus,
sweet Jesus,
how I love
calling your name.
Oh, Jesus,
sweet Jesus,
every day
your name is the same. Jesus, Jesus,
ooh,
how I love to call your name. Calling your name, Jesus,
Jesus,
how I love to call your name. Calling your name,
Jesus,
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 how I love to call your name. Calling your name,
Jesus,
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 how I love to call your name. Calling your name,
calling your name,
Jesus.
Good morning, church. Glad to be here with Ferguson Heights Church of Christ. Today's scripture will be from the book of 2 Kings, chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. That's 2 Kings, chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. And it reads, "And the sons of the prophet said to Elisha, 'See now, the place where we dwell with you is too small for us. Please let us go to Jordan and let every man take a beam from there and let us make there a place where we may dwell.' So he answered, 'Go.' Then one said, 'Please consent to go with your servants.' And he answered, 'I will go.' So he went with them. And when they came to the Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water, and he cried out and said, 'Alas, master, for it was borrowed.' So the man of God said, 'Where did it fall?' And he showed him the place. So he cut off a stick and threw it in there, and he made the iron float. Therefore, he said, 'Pick it up for yourself.' So he reached out his hand and took it." Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for being able to worship you and receive your word. We thank you, Lord, for choosing us as your children and for the comfort and peace you give us. Father, we thank you for picking us up when we stumble and for your forgiveness of our sins when we fall short. We thank you for answering our prayers and fulfilling our needs when we don't have the means at hand. We thank you for protecting us and being our rock and being our hope in these dark times of peril. Lord, be with us when we worry and guide us safely through with courage to do your will. Thank you for being a friend when we feel alone, for teaching us your loving ways. Bless us with peace and protection. Bless us with humble leaders. Anoint them to guide with wisdom, righteousness, and caring hearts. Father, be with us as we seek you and give us the patience to wait on you as you make clear the path safe for us as we journey through these troubling days ahead. Lord, we also want to thank you for the blessings you've given us for our co-minister, Brother Gary Lodge, who comes before us to teach and preach your gospel today. God, bless us with the fruit of this sermon, that we have a clear focus to hear and to understand the words, and most of all, learn to apply God's ways to our daily lives. We send these prayers to the God, our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Sometimes it's hard to tell the night from day. Still, the hope that lies within is reassured as I keep my eyes upon the dead. Unsure, I know he'll lead me safely to that blessed place he has prepared.
But if the storms don't cease, and if the winds keep blowing, my left me by myself, and the road seems to get longer day by day. Well, my God will lead me through the ups and downs. And my God will give me strength to fight the fight and make it through the toils and snares of this old world and present day. By the waves and the currents that seem so fierce, but in the word of God
Oh. morning and welcome to Ferguson Heights Church of Christ YouTube channel. My name is Gary Lodge. I'm one of the ministers here at Ferguson Heights. And this month, we want to start a series with four lessons on spiritual secrets. This morning's lesson will be the secret of tragedy. We want to welcome those who are visiting with us and say that you are indeed honored guests. We don't take your visit lightly. We certainly appreciate you coming by. And we know that this is time out of your busy schedule that you could be doing something else. But we thank you for sharing with us and just being here with us in our worship service. We hope that God will send down God's blessings on you and your family and your loved ones, and that he will bless you in a particular way, in a special way, that is particular to your needs this morning. If you will, I ask that you will open up your Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 6. And the verses that we'll be particularizing this morning is verses 1 through 7. If you have your copy of God's word, I ask that you read along with me. The Bible says in 2 Kings chapter 6 and verse number 1, "And the sons of the prophets said unto Elisha, Behold now, the place where we dwell with thee is too strait for us. Let us go, we pray thee, unto Jordan, and take thence every man a beam, and let make a place there where we may dwell. And he answered, Go ye. And one said, Be content, I pray thee, and go with thy servants. He answered, I will go. So he went with them, and when they came to Jordan, they cut down wood. But as one was flailing a beam, the axe head fell into the water. And he cried and said, Alas, master, for it was borrowed. And the man of God said, Where fell it? And he showed him the place. And he cut a stick and cast it into the water, and the iron did swim. Therefore, said he, Take it up unto thee. And he put out his hand and took it. May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing of his word. This story in 2 Kings is kind of sandwiched between two stories. The first story is about a greedy servant of Elisha. And the second story that comes after is about a king preparing for war. And I find it just fascinating that this story is caught in between greed and war. It seems that it may be an insignificant story, one that doesn't really have any particular reason to be where it is. The story upon the surface, by looking at it, doesn't really say anything. A man lost an axe handle. A prophet cut a piece of wood and put it into the water, and the axe head floated. What's the significance of this? But this story has deep and spiritual, practical lessons for us this morning. And if you have time, I think I will be able to share with you some of those particulars, if you will. The axe head is the keen cutting edge of a life that is equipped with power, driven by the Holy Spirit. I say it again. The axe head represents the keen cutting edge of our life that is empowered by the Holy Spirit. The loss and the recovery of the axe head is an illustration or an illustrative picture of the manner in which God matches the misery of our human tragedy with the miracle of divine victory. Sometimes we find our lives in tragedy, and we wonder how in the world we are going to get ourselves out of that tragedy. The loss and the recovery illustrates that we sometimes get in trouble and God needs to pull us out. Somebody ought to say amen. Have you ever lost a keen cutting edge? Is it your witness or your service that you have no longer in your life? Is it your effectiveness for God's work that you have lost? Is it something that is dear to the service of God that you no longer have? More importantly, do you know where you can go back and recover it? And if you can't answer those questions in the affirmative, then perhaps this lesson is for you this morning. If you can't give an answer for where you lost your power, if you can't give an answer to when you lost your power, if you can't give an answer to where you can recover your power, then this lesson is for you this morning. To appreciate the personal application of this fascinating Old Testament story, you need to observe the significance of the losing of the axe head. If you can't understand what significance it has, then you may not be able to grasp the measure and the power of this lesson this morning. Losing the axe head. The servant cried out to the man of God and said, "My Lord, you do not understand. This axe head was borrowed." With the simple lifestyle of the prophets, we have every reason to assume that the loaning of the axe head, number one, was a compassionate provision of a benefactor. Somebody knew that this man needed tools to do his work. Somebody had compassion enough to give this man tools to do his work. Somebody recognized that we cannot do our work without the proper tools to get the job done. Somebody ought to say amen. 2 Kings chapter 6 and verse number 5, the Bible says it was borrowed. And the lesson we find that difficult to learn, sometimes we pride ourselves on our accomplishments. We pride ourselves on what we have done. We pride ourselves on how much we are capable of. And we pride ourselves on the accomplishments and the achievements, and we forget to recognize. We forget to recognize that all that we have. Oh, let me slow down for a minute. Let that sink in for a minute. We pride ourselves on our achievements and our accomplishments. And we forget to recognize the compassionate provisions of our heavenly benefactor. Lord, I thank you for waking me up this morning. Lord, I thank you for allowing me to have my right sense this morning. Lord, I thank you for allowing me to borrow the money that I have in my pocket, Lord. Lord, I thank you for allowing me to borrow the car that I drove over here in. Lord, I thank you for allowing me to just have my life this morning. I thank you for this borrowed time that you have given to me. Lord, I just thank you for all that you have given me. I thank you for your benevolence. The Bible says, who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? If God was willing to loan us his son, somebody ought to say amen. God allowed his son to die on the cross that you and I would not have to die that death that Jesus died. Romans chapter 8 and verse number 32. And again, the Bible says every good and perfect gift is from above and come down from the Father of light with whom there is no variances or shadows of turning. That's James chapter 1 and verse number 17. So we can say with James McGurney, "Nought have I gotten anything that I have received. Grace has bestowed is since I believe. Everything that I have in this life come from my heavenly Father. The breath that I breathe comes from my heavenly Father." But you know, it's easy to think about me breathing breath, but even the air that I breathe in comes from my heavenly Father. Oh, I wish I had somebody know what I'm talking about this morning. During his last hour, James Knox woke from a slumber and slide and told his friends that he had just been tempted to believe that he had merited heaven and eternal blessings by the faithful discharge of his ministry. But blessed be God, whom have enabled me to beat down and to quench the fiery darts by suggesting to me such passages of scripture as these. Why hast thou done this that thou receive? By the grace of God, I am what I am. Not I, but the grace of God with me. James was just simply saying that, you know, everything that we have is by the grace of God. I might think that I'm all that. I might think that I'm so smart. I might think that I look good. I might think that I have it all together. But everything that I have, God has given unto me. So we need to understand, first of all, the compassionate provision of the benefactor. But then we need to also consider the conditional provision of the benefactor. Going back to the verse, the prophet said, "Alas, master." Verse 5, "For it was borrowed." The very cry of this man indicates that he was under obligation. Are y'all still out there? He was under obligation. Indeed, he was not only responsible for the scheduled task of cutting down the trees, but he was also accountable for the supply too. Oh, you don't hear me. He was responsible for the task that he was given, but he was also accountable for the tools that were loaned to him. Story revealed that the training center had become too small and further construction was under an urgent necessity. I might tell you sometimes that when we're doing the work of God, we'll outgrow the place that we're in. Somebody need to help me this morning. To do this task, the sons of the prophet was now committed. Even so, and they were obligated to do this task. They were obligated because they had a task of sharing the word of God, but they also had a task of building a place for them to live. And when you begin to do God's work and you begin to share God's word, then you will not help but find growth. You might not grow where you are. Amen, if you can. See, God is ever moving on. We may be standing still, but God is not standing still. God will continue to move on in spite of us. Where the spirit is unhindered in evangelistic enterprise, there is expansion. For this reason, God holds us personally responsible for the task and the accountability of our tools. The Bible says over in Romans, some have been given varying gifts, and we need to share our gifts with other folk. You know, I love the beauty of the fact that all of us don't have the same gifts in the church. Because if all of us had the same gifts, then we would all want to be the hammer. If we all had the same gift, then all of us would want to be the nail. If we all had the same gifts, all of us would want to be the saw. If we had the same gifts, all of us would want to be the measuring tool. All of us would want to be what we ought not to be. Somebody else say amen. If I need a hammer, I need a hammer. If I need a ruler, I need a ruler. If I need a nail, I need a nail. And God has laid us in the church so that we all have varying gifts. And we ought to be accountable. We are accountable for those gifts that we have. And we need to use them for the furtherance of the kingdom of God. Amen, if you can. We are personally responsible. We have a personal responsibility. If God loans you a tool, you ought to use it to its effectiveness. Remember one day that God is going to require that you bring that tool home. And when you have brought that tool, I'm not expecting that God will expect me to bring the tool back shiny and all sharp just like it was when he gave it to me. Amen, if you can. I'm not expecting that God is wanting me to bring the tool back without any chips on it and not any mars on it. I'm not expecting that God will want me to bring the axe back with a sharp edge on it. I am expecting that God would want me to bring the tool back used, not abused, but used. Somebody ought to say amen. And so we are personally accountable for it. Reminds me of those who received the talents. One took it and buried it. Another took it out and invested it. And I think that God wants us to take what God has given us and invest it and not bury it. Somebody ought to say amen if you can. You know, by the incoming and infilling of the Holy Spirit, every believer is made responsible and accountable to heaven for the way he or she uses or misuses or even abuses their time and their talent. Somebody told me a while back that we only have 168 hours in a week. You can check the math if you want to. I haven't. I just am going by what somebody else said. And if I got it wrong, that's okay. But if you only have a certain amount of time in a week, then your time is no more time than my time. I do know that everybody has 24 hours in a day. Somebody ought to help me. Amen. And you can count that up on minutes and seconds if you want to. But however you want to lay it out, you and I all have the same time while we are breathing here on earth. And God is looking at whether we use, misuse, or abuse that time. Oh, the cry of the prophet's son might be heard more often among us, Master, for it was borrowed. It was borrowed. I am on borrowed time, and I will have to return it someday. The secret of tragedy. When tragedy comes into your life, how do you handle it? What do you take away from it? Do you wallow in your misery? Or do you allow tragedy to teach you what God wants to use you for? So we look at the loaning of the axe head. But the next thing that we want to share with you this morning is not only the loaning of the axe head, but the losing of the axe head. But one while he was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. 2 Kings 6:5, once again. Here we are faced with the most solemn warning which we need to heed. The Spirit of God teaches us here that it is possible. It is possible for us to lose our cutting edge, our usefulness, our power for service. It teaches us that it's possible to lose that edge that we have. It's possible that we will lose the tool that we have. It's possible to lose the usefulness that we have. It's possible for us to lose the power of service that we have. And you need to pay particular attention to something, because I don't want you to miss this. If you miss this, then you're going to miss the importance of the whole lesson. The losing of the axe head, first of all, it happened while he was diligently in his daily work. Think about that for a minute. Because too often we think about, when we talk about people, think about folk who lose their what they have and the usefulness for God, we always say, well, you know, they were just lazy. They didn't do anything with what they had. As one was cutting down the tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. This man never lost his axe head because he was lazy. He never lost his axe head because he was idle. He never lost his axe head because he was not being busy. He was busy, and perhaps he was the most busiest man on the work team. The suggestion is that he was probably the one who came to Elisha and said, Master, we need to build a bigger place. We need to go to Jordan and cut down some trees. And Master, I would like you to come with me. Perhaps that's kind of the flavor that I'm getting from this. And it may not be the same disciple that came or the prophet that came to him, but it suggests that he may have been the most busiest one in the whole crew. What a word. What a word. And the word for us today is that busyness does not equate effectiveness. The fact that he was busy in the Lord's service is no final evidence that we will endure the power from high. It doesn't mean you can be busy. A lot of folk are busy doing things. Amen, if you can. But unfortunately, there's so many Christian activity today is nothing more than noise without power. We see a lot of noise going on. We hear a lot of talk about what we are doing. But it may be noise without power, motion without progress, show without reality. One of my favorite illustrations that I've learned along my Christian journey is that, you know, is the rocking chair illustration. The rocking chair illustration is one that I have used over and over and over again, and it just seems like it breeds a whole lot of application. You see, the rocking chair will keep you busy. It'll keep you in motion, but it will not take you anywhere. And I know some folks say, well, yeah, I can just scoot it up, but you know, that's slow progress. It'd be better if you got up and walk where you need to go than trying to scoot the rocking chair. Somebody need to help me this morning. God have mercy on a man or a woman who tries to serve without the spirit or power of God's blessing in their lives. You see, I don't just want to do something. I want to do what God wants me to do. John Henry Fabry, a French scientist and naturalist, conducted an unusual experiment with some caterpillars. And the caterpillars are called processionary caterpillars. And a processionary caterpillar is a caterpillar who follows behind the lead caterpillar. And wherever the lead caterpillar goes, by touching the tail of the lead caterpillar, each caterpillar behind it just follows right along. So what he did was he took the lead caterpillar, put it around a flower pot, and touched all the rest of them around. And he kept putting them around till the lead and the end caterpillars would touch it. And then he put some pine cones in the middle of the flower pot. Food that the caterpillars like to eat. 7 days and seven nights later, the caterpillars were still going around in a circle, not going for the food. Finally, they died from exhaustion and starvation, going around in circles, making no progress, missing it. His experiments, it tells us that we confuse activity sometime with accomplishment. They were active. They were moving, but they did not accomplish anything other than death. Many Christians make that mistake, confusing activity with accomplishment. I hear it all the time. Well, they'll be doing more in the church. And then you ask, what more should we do? And folk come up with all kinds of ideas about what we need to do. Activity. But it's not really accomplishing the word of God, the will of God. Our primary purpose is to lead folk to God. Our secondary purpose is, after we have led folk to God and folk have accepted God, is to maintain the life of those folk so that they will make it from here to eternity. So if we are not doing activities, then we are not accomplishing the things that we need to do if they don't direct us in those two major focuses, to save souls and to serve souls. As souls are going from here to eternity, then that's not accomplishment. You have a witness? Not only did it happen while he was diligently working, but it also happened while he was negligent in his daily work. It can happen while you are negligent in your daily work. You can lose your cutting edge while you are diligently working, but you can lose your cutting edge while you are negligently working in your daily work. The Bible says, but one that was cutting down the tree, the axe head fell into the water. The sons of the prophet had a mind to work. There's no doubt about that. The sons of the prophet said, we need to do something about our present situation. The sons of the prophet said, we need to get a bigger space. We have no problem with going out and cutting down trees and building a new edifice. But diligently working is not wrong. He had a mind to work, but you know, he didn't have a mind to watch. He was blind to the fact that the axe head was slacking and slipping off of the shaft. He was working so hard that he was not watching what was going on around him. Somebody ought to say amen. Tragedy occurs He lost his axe head in the dark, muddy water of the Jordan. Jesus told his disciples to watch. And I like what Jesus said. He said, now, you need to pray. That's important. It's important for you to pray, but you need to watch also. And sometimes we get caught up in prayer. I often hear many answers to things that are going on around us. We hear when we ask about, well, what are we going to do about civil unrest? And a lot of folks say, we ought to pray about it. Well, that's good. Prayer is good. But Jesus told his disciples, you need to watch also. Don't just pray about it. You need to watch. And I think that what he was talking about is that when he says watch, he's telling them, lest that you enter into temptation, you need to watch yourself as well as pray about stuff, because you can get so caught up in prayer that you miss what's going on around you. And your temptation can drag you away. Somebody need to help me. It's the fact that more spiritual breakdowns can be traced back to negligent devotion in life than any other cause in life. You need to be watchful about what's going on. Don't let just things come up on you, because you can stay on your knees and folk can tempt you with things and you get off your knees and you haven't been paying attention to what's going on around you. You can fast so much that you get up and eat and become a glutton because you've fasted so much. Watch. Be careful. Don't allow yourself to get so caught up in one avenue that you forget about all the rest of your life. Somebody need to help me. I think the primary example from the Old Testament and from the Bible is Samson, who lost his power while diligently working. Samson lost his power but because he was diligently working, but he was neglectful in his watching. He was paying attention to all of the evil that was going on in the kingdom, but he wasn't watching the woman that he was laying down with. His spiritual life began to slip. He was watching and being careful about those who were opposed to God. But he was sharing his secrets with the wrong person because he wasn't watchful. Somebody need to help me. He did not know that the Lord had departed from him, went to sleep, woke up, went out to do the same work that he'd always done in the same way that he had always done it. And when he woke up, he hadn't watched while he was asleep. Hair is now missing. Gets up, don't even realize that his hair is gone. Goes out to demonstrate his strength. But he didn't know that the Lord had departed from him. I say that again. He did not know that the Lord had departed from him because he had failed to watch his connection and his relationship with the Lord. Sometimes we can get so caught up in things that we miss the fact that the Lord has left us. Beware of losing your power with God and with man. You see, sometimes we lose not only our power with God, but we lose our influence with our fellow man. It's important that we keep our relationship with God, but we also need to keep our relationship with our fellow man. Because if we lose our relationship with God, we are destined to lose our relationship with our fellow man. But on the other hand, we don't want to keep our fellowship with our fellow man and lose our relationship with God. Both are important. God works through us to help our fellow man. It can happen while you are diligently working, yet neglecting or negligent in your watching. Lord, preserve us all. The secret of tragedy. The secret of tragedy. And as I try and hasten to bring this thing to a close, the third thing that I want to share with you this morning is this. We've seen the loaning of the axe head. We've seen the losing of the axe head. But now let us look at the locating of the axe head. The Bible says, and the man of God said, where did it fall? And he showed him the place. So the man of God cut off a stick and threw it there. And he made the iron to float in verse number 6 of 2 Kings chapter 6. Once again, we are confronted with a solemn instruction. When the cutting edge is gone and the power has been lost, what is the only way to recover it? That's a question. When your cutting edge has been lost and your power has been lost, how do you recover it? I'm glad you asked. And if you're questioning that, then the answer is twofold. The first is the explanation of human problems. And the man of God said, "Where did it fall?" And he showed him the place. The hardest thing for us to do when we've lost something is to remember where we lost it. Are y'all still out there? Same goes for the backslider. To explain where we went astray. We know we're in trouble, but backtracking and trying to get back to where it all took place, sometimes we don't even want to think about that. Explain how we went astray, how we lost our power. But the Lord Jesus demand that the man of God or the woman of God retrace their steps. Be particular about where they lost the power of God. Or you say, "Brother Elijah, I don't know. Is there scripture for that?" Yes, it is. It's a principle of scripture that place of departure is the place of recovery. Psychiatrists know this. They trace folk back and take them back to where things went wrong. Make you tell your life story so that you can figure out exactly where you lost yourself. You will only find the power where you lost it. It's futile to imagine that you can overlook the past without accounting for it and confessing what you did wrong. The Bible says God requires an account of what is past. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse number 15. God said, you got to talk about your past. You've got to go back into your past. You've got to remember what you did wrong. And again, my favorite passage, 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 9, the Bible says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He says, now you have to confess your sins. And let me help you understand confession, because I think I've shared it with you before. The word there is homo legio. Homo means the same. Lego means to say. God says that you've got to say the same thing that God already knows. See, it's not a surprise to God where you went wrong. It's not a surprise to God what went wrong. It's not a surprise to God when it went wrong. But what you need to do is confess it, own it, respect it, acknowledge it, and God will help you to recover from it. Somebody need to help me this morning. Some people have had to return to sin committed previous years before God restored them to the joy and the power of the Holy Spirit. So you need to know where you lost your power. You need to make an accounting of what went wrong. And if it went wrong with somebody, the Bible says that if you have a problem with your brother or your sister, you need to go to that person and get it right. But you see, that's going back to where it all went wrong. And many times we don't want to return to where we did wrong. Many times we don't want to go back to where we went wrong, because if we go back to where we went wrong, we have to acknowledge that we did wrong. But that's what confession is all about. The word homo legio simply means that you have to say the same thing that God has said. You have to say the same thing where God has said it. You have to do the same thing that God says you need to do in order for you to get it right with God and with the person that you have done wrong. You cannot get restored until you go back and get it right. Show God where the place is. Show God the time that it happened. Show God the circumstance that it happened. And let me just share with you again. It's not so much about showing God, but it's about showing yourself and acknowledging it so you can move on from it. Explain to God the problem. Man of God cried out, Master, I have lost the axe head. It was borrowed. It does not belong to me. Where did it take place? Right over there. He threw a stick in the water and the iron floated. Explain the problem, for God already knows the problem. Nothing is hidden from God. Confession is the way to recovery. Somebody need to help me. So you need to the explanation of human problem, but then there's the application of divine power. It's twofold, as I said, to recover. The application of divine power, and the lesson will be yours. The Bible says in verse number 6, so he cut off a stick, threw it in there, and he made the iron to float. Therefore, he said to him, pick it up for yourself. Don't miss that. So he reached out with his hand and he took it. To believe in the God is to believe in miracles. God can help us. And I know that we don't believe that miracles happen, but anytime God intervenes in our life and pull us out of a mess, that's a miracle. But an obvious miracle happened here. Note the action of the man of God. He cut off a stick. God does God's part. Are y'all still there? He cut off a stick. And Jesus is referred to in the scripture as the branch in Isaiah chapter 11 and verse number 1. The application of divine power is always the answer to human needs. God is going to work with us, but the application of this divine power is always the answer to our human needs. When the message of the crucified Christ is applied to our problem, there's always release. There's always restoration. But we have to go back and fix it. You know, if you're working on something and just for instance, you had an accident in your car. And you go out and you observe your car. And you see a nice, neat little dent in your car. In order to be released from that, if the accident was your fault, you got to make restitution to the person who you hit. In order to restore your car, you got to take it to somebody. If you may be capable of doing it, but more than likely, you need to take it to somebody to fix it. So our release is, sometimes we have to go back and get right with folk that we have done wrong. The restoration of our self is that we've got to take this to somebody who's powerful and more capable than us to fix it. Somebody need to help me. Observing the story that Elisha cut off the branch and threw it into the river. The iron axe floated on the surface, but here was liberation. It not only overcame the law of gravity, but it also overcame the strength of the current. And I think that's beautiful. The axe head floated, but the water and the current didn't move it. It stayed right where it was. And that's what God does for us. When God causes us to rise again, God is capable enough to stabilize us and strengthen us and keep us in a stable position where we won't float away. I think that's what Ephesians says, that we won't be carried away with every wind of doctrine. Strong winds may blow, strong waters may come, but the child of God will not float away, because the child of God has been restored and released by God. And so when you have been released and restored by God, you don't have to worry about being washed away by the winds. You don't have to be washed away by the waters. You can stay in a stable position. This reminds us of what Paul's word said in Romans chapter 8 and verse number 2, the law of the spirit of life in Jesus Christ has made me free from the law of sin and death. God has liberated me. God has released me. God has stabilized me so I can stand up, be strengthened day by day to make one step at a time. The depth of the water of the Jordan and the currents of the rivers were no match for the application of the divine power of God. The winds may blow. The world may go crazy. Everything around me be going around in circles, but God is capable of keeping me strong and stable. Somebody need to help me this morning. Thank God. In the cross of Jesus Christ, there's liberation and restoration. For every backslider, every defeated Christian, for every fruitless believer, God will restore you. God can strengthen you. If you find yourself in a position where you have gone astray a little bit, God can bring you back. If you feel like you are a defeated Christian, God can lift you up again. If you feel like you are a fruitless Christian, God can give you back your fruitfulness again. Amen, if you can. You need to accept that God's sentence on the death of your failure. God is capable of putting your failure to death and for putting your sin to death also. And then God will ask you just to take God's power in your life by faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. Faith is the evidence of things not seen, the evidence of things hoped for. Amen. We just continue to believe in God. Power for service can be restored. If you have found yourself that you are not working in the church like you used to, then God can restore that power. If God can prepare you to do what you need to do for God. Somebody needs to say amen. God is prepared to show you that God is capable and able of doing it. The secret of tragedy. I've shared with you a couple of things. I've shared with you the loaning of the axe head. I've shared with you the losing of the axe head. I've shared with you the locating of the axe head. And I think there's a beautiful lesson for us to learn. God can restore us even in our tragedy. The secret of tragedy, the secret of spiritual secrets is what we're talking about. And the first one is the secret of tragedy. Tragedy does not have to debilitate us, does not have to destroy us. It can liberate us. And can bring us restoration. God can restore us to what God wants us to be. And we've seen how God has taken the life that lost in the muddy waters of defilement and death and raised it up to new life and power. And many Christians that we are with, God perhaps have raised you up many times before. God is willing to do it again. Remember, your axe head is loaned. It's not yours. And one day you're going to have to return it. It can be lost, but thank God it can be located and recovered. Amen, if you can. Although believers can never lose their power of the Spirit, you know, you can lose the presence of the Spirit and the power of the Spirit. You can never lose the person of the Spirit, rather, in your life. Once we have been endowed with the Holy Spirit, we can't lose that, but we can lose the presence and we can lose the power. The Bible says, Paul said, don't quench the Spirit. In other words, the Spirit is still in you, just don't quench it. Don't pour cold water on it. Let the power of the Spirit move in you. Surely this is what Sylvia Rose had in mind when she wrote, "Restore my spirit, Lord. You know, Lord, my heart is weary. Please help me, dear Lord. I stand in need of more strength from your word. Renew me. Rebuild my faith. Oh, restore my soul. Revive the fire, Lord, deep down in my soul. Won't you please, Lord, steer my desire to work in your fold. Light in my heart, dear Lord. Your zeal has grown cold. Renew my love. Rebuild my faith. Oh, restore my soul. Restore my courage, Lord. It needs restore. Yes, it does, for my cup is empty. Refill it, dear Lord. Refill all doubts and fear with faith so bold. Renew my love. Rebuild my faith. Oh, restore my soul. The secret of tragedy. I don't know what tragedy you may have had in your life. I don't know what you've gone through. I don't know where you are right now. I don't know why you don't feel the power of God. I don't know why or when you lost the power of God. I don't know where you lost the power of God. I don't know how you need restoring. I don't know why you need restoring, but that's not important. The important thing is I have shown you how you can be restored. For all of those who have not been not members of the body of Christ, you come by hearing his word. By believing the same, by confessing to Jesus Christ to be the Son of God, by repenting of your sin and being baptized for the remission of your sin. And if you should fall away from that glorious day that you became a Christian, you have opportunity to become back. If we confess our sins, he is just to forgive us of our sins. Restore my soul, Lord. the secret of tragedy. You don't have to live in tragedy. That's the secret. You don't have to stay in your tragedy. You can be released, delivered, and restored. God bless you, and may God keep you. Amen.
Everybody ought to hold to his hand.
Hold on to God's
unchanging hand.
Everybody ought to hold on
to his hand.
Hold on to God's
unchanging hand.
I know we can
build on things
eternal.
Changing hand,
yeah.
Unchanging hand.
If you're burdened,
hold on to his hand.
Hold on to God's
unchanging hand.
You ought to hold
to his hand.
Hold on to God's
unchanging hand.
I know we can
build your hopes
on things
eternal.
Up in heaven.
Hold to God's unchanging hand,
his unchanging
hand.
You know
time
is filled with swift
transition.
Yes it is, yes it is now.
No
love
unmoved can stay.
You ought to build
your hopes
on things
eternal.
And you ought to
hold
on
to God's unchanging hand.
Everybody ought to
hold
on
to his hand.
Hold on to my
God's unchanging hand.
Everybody ought to hold
on to his hand.
Hold on to my
God's unchanging hand.
I know you can
be
on things
eternal,
that'll last forever and ever and ever. You ought to
hold on to God's unchanging hand,
his
unchanging hand.
If you're ever in trouble, you ought to know you can
trust
in him,
cause
he won't leave
you.
No, he won't, no, he won't, no matter
what
whatsoever
years may bring.
If they turn and walk away from you, you can
still more closely to him.
Oh, my brothers ought to
hold on to his hand.
Hold on to my
God's unchanging hand.
Brother, you got to hold on
to his hand.
Hold on to
God's unchanging hand. On things eternal.
Yes, you can. I know we can. And we would
hold
on
to God's unchanging
hand.
His unchanging
hand. Thought I'd tell you to
curve
it, not this world.
Pain riches.
Pain riches.
Because
they so rapidly decay. Seek to gain
the heavenly
treasure, because
they will never pass away.
All the sisters ought to
hold to his hand.
Hold on to
God's unchanging hand.
Sister,
hold on
to his
hand.
Now it's time we've come to communion. And communion, a ritual that was instituted by Jesus during his last supper, giving the disciples bread and wine during the Passover meal. He commanded, "Do this in remembrance of me," the bread representing my body, the wine representing my blood, as the new covenant. It is a commandment of remembrance to be shared amongst believers and taught to non-believers that Jesus Christ came to save us, and only through him in the path to eternal life in heaven. Two sacraments are taken on the first day of each week where believers commune in remembrance of him. The bread sacrifice represents his body that's been beaten and broken, and the wine sacrament represents the new covenant with God through his blood. Jesus is our direct mediator to God the Father. Jesus purchased our sins with his death, giving up his earthly body to erase all away our sins. And through the blood and the new covenant with the Father, Jesus promised his followers a priceless gift, the greatest reward, eternal life in heaven to all faithful believers. Jesus will go to the Father on our behalf on judgment day and vouch for us so that the heavenly gates will be open for us someday. Let us go to Matthew 26, verses 26 through 29. And it reads, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, take it, eat it. This is my body. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remissions of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we adore you. We love you. We know that the torture, the suffering that you went through was all for us, to give us a chance to have eternal life. And we are gratefully thankful for your sacrifice and for your perseverance. We do this in remembering you by passing down your word and teaching your word to those who are non-believers and to those that we bring up in this world, our own offspring from generation to generation. We owe tribute to you, we glorify you, and thank you for all what you've done, and the Father for sending his only begotten Son to us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
will agree. Said he was wounded
for our transgressions.
Oh Lord, said
he was bruised.
We have come to the portion of the service where it's time for the church offering, an opportunity for us to give back some of what God has purposed and prospered us. The Lord expects us to give freely, not out of guilt, but with thanksgiving, without tension, but willfully, and with a generous heart. Your offering helps to pay for the church mortgage, utilities, building upkeep, and the furtherance of his kingdom that support our church ministries like Benevolence and Food Pantry, just to name a few. We offer three ways to give: two online using the Zelle app or PayPal app at ferguson.church/give, and you can come up to the church and drop off your gifts through the drop box. So let us go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 15, where it talks about giving. And it is the New King James Version. So that's 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 15. And it reads, "But this day I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he prospers, at purpose in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. As it is written, he has dispersed abroad, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and multiply the seeds you have sown and increase the fruit of your righteousness, while you are enriched in everything for all liberality, which causes thanksgiving through us to God. For the administration of this service not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also is abounding through many thanksgivings to God. While through the proof of this ministry, they glorify God for the obedience of your confession to the gospel of Christ and for your liberal sharing with them and all men. And by their prayer for you, who long for you because of the exceeding grace of God in you, thanks be to God for his indescribable gifts." Let us pray. Thank you, God, for all that you have given us. You have blessed us in many ways. You fulfill our needs daily and provide shelter for us. And for these reasons, we are joyfully thankful. thank you, thankful for this opportunity to give back a portion of what you have blessed us with for the furtherance of your kingdom. Sweet Lamb of God, we give you all the praise and glory. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Going through, held on
to me, stuck right by me. Lord, you've been my only friend. You have been right in my corner, and I thank you, Lord. Don't know what I would have done without you right here in my life, Lord. And I just gotta say, hey.
All right, this is part of our worship service where we doing announcements. I only have a few announcements here. We want to congratulate our baptisms for the month of July. And they were Neora, Ella, and Enoch, who were baptized here at the Ferguson Heights Church of Christ. Those were the three baptisms we had this month. We want to congratulate them and keep them in our prayers. And also, we want to remind everyone to make sure they pick up their bread from their Panera bread from Panera that will be left up here on Saturday. I hope everyone picked their bread up yesterday. They bring it up here every Saturday for us to pick up. So don't hesitate to come up here and pick up some bread. If you don't want it, just give it to some loved ones or something. Also, Wednesday Bible study. We want to make sure that everybody tune in to Wednesday Bible study. It's 7 o'clock p.m. There's a number that you can call to tune in. Are you looking at your bulletins for that number? Okay, one more announcement. We have a leadership meeting, a brother's leadership meeting this Thursday at 7 o'clock, 7 o'clock p.m. So don't forget, brothers of the leaders of Church of Christ, Ferguson Heights Church of Christ, to make sure you attend. That's all the announcements I have for today. Okay, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you again for this another day, Father, that you've blessed us with, Father. We thank you, Father, for being in our presence this day, Father, as we went about our services, Father. We pray, trust, and hope that we did things in a manner that was pleasing and acceptable to you, Father. And Father, we want to continue to pray for the doctors and nurses, Father, and the first responders, and all the essential workers, Father, that are out there putting their lives on the line for us, Father. And first and foremost, Father, we want to ask you to continue to bless the ministers in this world, Father, to continue to spread your word throughout this land, Father. We thank you for that. And before our feet hit these streets, Father, we ask that you arm us with a helmet of salvation, sword of the Holy Spirit, and shield of faith. These blessings we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus. Pray, amen.
Jordan River. One more.